In this session, on numerical methods, I like to finish our session on floating point arithmetic, computer arithmetics. So the session that actually showed us that we have to be a little bit careful when programming mathematical formulas in the computer, that we get the accurate result. So there are easy mistakes. So we started discussing computer arithmetics by introducing integers and floating point numbers. So the denormalized and normalized floating point numbers. And there was a very important result for the normalized floating point numbers. So the normalized floating point numbers are the ones that stay away from zero. So the ones that are in this interval. So a huge range, 2 to the power of e min, which is minus 1000 something, and 2 to the power of e max. For the numbers that are within this range, we have that the relative error has a bound. So the relative error is bounded, the relative rounding error. And the rounding error is the error we have on a single operation result. So it's bounded by 2 to the minus p plus 1. So that's half the step of two such numbers on the same scale. So this here is approximately, so this is 2 to the power of minus 53 for floating point double, which is approximately 10 to the minus 16. So that is for double precision numbers. Okay, so we had that result. And we already made the observation that when we have a very small number, like our epsilon. So epsilon is here 10 to the minus 16 for floating point doubles. And we add that number to 1, then it will be, the result will be rounded back to 1 and it will be 1 again. So the floating point number 1 plus epsilon is not distinguishable from 1. And this is the root for many problems. And now I would like to look what it does to summation. And summation is very important to us. So when we will look in the next session into the Monte Carlo method, then we need to calculate the expectation of a random variable and consider a discrete random variable, say X, which is equidistributed. So equidistributed, every event has the same probability. Discrete, the probability is 1 divided by n, n is the number of events. Then you have that the expectation of X is just 1 divided by n, I from, if you start counting in zero, it's I from zero to n minus one, and then it's x of omega I. Okay, that's the expectation. So you see, we need to calculate the sum. Okay, so we need to calculate the sum here. We are looking at summation. And the classical way to calculate now the sum, or here the average of this random variable. So calculating here the average of such an equidistributed random variable, the expectation is here this little algorithm. So I loop over all elements of my random variable. So here realizations is an array, and that here is my capital x of omega I, so which is maybe an xi, okay? So, and then I just sum all these guys up. So we initialize the sum to zero, and then we perform sum is equal to sum plus a new value. And in the end, we divide by n. Oh, okay, so in the end here, we divide by n. So this is the sum divided by the number of elements, n. Okay, so and what can go wrong? I like to make a small exercise, programming example. So let's try the following. We calculate the expectation of a sequence xi, where all xi are the same, but we have a huge number of elements. Yeah? So here we have n equals, this is, I believe, 10 million elements. Of course, the average of all these numbers is just the number itself, because all the numbers are the same. Yeah, so we have n times c divided by n is c. Let's try that in a small experiment. Let's call it a summation experiment. So I define here an integer or a long, yeah, which is my number of values, say number of values. So this is my 10 million. Okay. And then I have a floating point number, the value, and I would calculate 10 million times the sum of value divided by 10 million. So let's call it here average classic, because it is the classic summation. So, and I pass these arguments. So that is the value and that is the number of values. And then let's print out the result. So let's print out the result. He complains, of course, here that this is not known. Yeah, so let's create that method and let's do now the summation algorithm. So I just do it like it was on the slide. So I define the sum, where I sum up all the elements. Then I have a loop. So for index I from 0 to number of values minus 1, yeah, so smaller than number of values, I perform sum is equal to sum plus the value. And I return sum divided by number of values, because that's the average. That's just the algorithm I had on the slide, except that here value is always the same. And let's run it. Yeah, maybe let's run it with a smaller number here, maybe just 10. Yeah, so it runs also faster. Yeah. And you see the result should be 0.1, but we get 0.099999. And there is a small rounding error, but the rounding error is around the machine precision. Okay, let's check. Yeah. So how many digits are we away from the machine precision? So there should be a 1 here, but we have a 9, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Yeah. So it's a 10 to the minus 16. We are off. Okay. So what happens if we do a 10 million here? Yeah. And we perform this summation again. So let's keep fingers crossed. Okay. And you see the error is increasing. Yeah? So now it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah. So we already lost some digits. Yeah, we already lost 6 or 7 digits in accuracy. Okay. And why is that? Well, if you go back to the slide, yeah, so you can immediately also guess a limit case, yeah, a dangerous limit case. Consider, for example, x zero is equal to 1, and xi is equal to epsilon for I is larger than 0. Then the first element of my summation is 1. And after that, I'm adding here epsilon to the 1, and 1 plus epsilon is 1. So it always stays 1. I'm adding stuff and it's always rounded away. Yeah. So we are always losing everything. And that's actually what is happening here. Okay, so we have always a small rounding error, and that's part of every summation step, and it's slowly eating into the result. Yeah. Okay, so that's a bit frightening, because in the Monte Carlo simulation, 10 million is not a big number. Yeah. So you see the calculation was quite fast. Yeah, I can take 100 million, and it's still fast in calculating this average here. Yeah, and you see the error is increasing. So we need a stable and robust summation algorithm. Okay, so as an algorithm that solves this problem is the Kahan summation, and I just want to develop this algorithm with you. Let's write down the classical summation algorithm again, yeah, in the general form. So how does the summation algorithm look like? So we initialized a sum, okay, and then we looped over all indices for which we need to sum, say, our realizations. So I call it just realizations, because I think of a random variable, the realizations of a random variable, but you can think of any array. So I iterate over all elements of my array. So then I fetch the value out of this array. So let's call that value. So I fetch this. So this is realizations I. And then I'm adding this to the sum. So what I do is I do sum is equal to sum plus value. Okay. And then the loop is over. And in the end, I return the sum. If I would like to return the sum, I return the sum, or I return the sum divided by realizations dot length. Yeah? So to calculate, the average. Okay. So, and the problem occurs here, where we have maybe a large value here and a small value here. Yeah, so like 1 plus epsilon. Can we check this? Yeah, so maybe we can check this. In order to check this, I have to introduce a temporary result for the sum, which I call new sum. So maybe I just make the algorithm a little bit more complicated, and I write here double new sum. So that's the new sum, okay? And then in the end, I just set sum is equal new sum. Okay, so I have not changed anything. Yeah, so I just have introduced a new variable, new sum, and I have assigned the result to this, and I just copied this over to the sum. Okay, but now that I have this variable, I can check actually the error. So let's introduce here a new variable. Let's call it error. I initialize to zero. I tell you why in a second. So now I have this variable. I can check the error. So the error is, okay, so I expect that the difference of new sum minus sum. So what should what's that? That should be value, right? So I can check if the value has been consumed by the new sum. Okay. So now at this point, I know the error. For example, if you have the case that sum is one and value is epsilon, then new sum will be one. And this guy here will be 1 minus 1, which is 0, and 0 minus epsilon. So the error will be minus epsilon. So, and the next step is that if we have the error, we can use the error in the next step. So in order to do that, I introduce here an error corrected value. So let's call that new value. So this value is value minus error. Yeah, so there's a minus because below, if the error is negative, yeah, so I have not added too much, yeah, so I need to add minus the error. And I use here this error corrected value now. Of course, here I have to use the new value. This is also a bit nicer. Looks a little bit ugly. New value. And that's the Kahan summation algorithm. Yeah. So you perform the summation, you check the error, and if you see there's an error, you will put it on the next value. And again, if that value will have an error, yeah, you will see it and you will put it on the next value. By this, the error will become larger if you accumulate small numbers until there will be not such a big rounding error when you add the value to the sum. Let's maybe illustrate this by looking at this little example I had on the slide before. So consider the case x0 is 1, x1 is epsilon, x2 is epsilon, and so on. Okay, and let's have a look at what all these numbers look like. So all the numbers that are involved. So the numbers that are involved are the sum. I set it to zero initially. Then the value I have to sum. So the first value I have to sum is one. Then the error. The error is initialized to zero. So having now a value and error, I calculate the new value, which is also just a one. So I calculate the new value, which is also a one. And I have the new sum, which is one, which is zero plus one, which is one. So then the new sum this guy is copied over to the sum. And I fetch a new value. So now my new value is maybe an epsilon. So I fetch the epsilon. So my error was zero. So that error here is also copied to there. So my value here is epsilon, which is epsilon plus zero. Yeah. So I have epsilon plus the previous error. This is epsilon plus zero. So the new sum is one plus epsilon. And here we have a one. Yeah. So here we have a rounding error. So then we check here this line. New sum is one. Sum is one. One minus one is zero. Value is epsilon, so minus epsilon. So the error will be minus epsilon. Minus epsilon. So then we copy over here the new sum. So that is the sum for the next iteration. I fetch the value, which is an epsilon. And now the new value is 2 epsilon. Because it is the value minus the error. So it is epsilon minus minus epsilon is 2 epsilon. And the new sum is 1 plus the new value, so which is 1 plus 2 epsilon. And here I don't have a rounding error. 1 plus epsilon is 1, but 1 plus 2 epsilon will be rounded to 1 plus 2 epsilon. So I don't have a rounding error. So I have 1 plus 2 epsilon. And I have an error, if I check it, of 0 again. Okay, and then you copy over the new sum to the sum. Okay, and then this moves on. Yeah, so let me complete it this quickly. So the epsilon, I get the epsilon, the error is 0. So here's an epsilon 2. But I have a rounding error again. So here I have a 1 plus 2 epsilon. So I have again an error of epsilon. So I have another 1 plus 2 epsilon here, yeah, which is the sum from the previous iteration. And then it goes on and another epsilon. But now we see there is another error. So it's again 2 epsilon, I have a 1 plus 4 epsilon, and I have an error of 0. So you see that here you always go in steps of 2, because the small step of 1 is too small, it's eaten up by the rounding. But we are keeping track of these errors here, and once the error is big enough, we can include the error again in the sum. Yeah, so we have rounding error in this little example at this place and at this place here, but then we are correct again. Why does this algorithm work? Okay, so this algorithm works because the problem here in this summation is that I have maybe a large number here and a small number here. So the error is the relative error is on the large scale. The rounding error lives on the scale of the sum. Yeah? So the error is on the large scale. So here I take the difference of these two sums. So it's the difference of two large scale numbers, but the difference is on the small scale. So this difference here is on the small scale. So I can accurately on the small scale, value is small, and this guy here is small, calculate the error. So the relative error, which is playing a role here, is on a much smaller scale. So the absolute error is much smaller than the error that plays a role here. That's the magic of this algorithm. So let's implement this algorithm very, very quickly and check that it works. So I'm a bit lazy, so I just copy here this nice little method, get average using, and now I write here Kahan summation. Yeah, so I now make these changes here. So I introduce my error tracker, my error accumulator here. So then I introduce my new value. So my new value here is value minus the previous error. And then I calculate the new sum. So new sum is sum plus new value. And then I check, is there an error in this summation? So error is new sum. So the new sum minus the old sum and the difference of this to new value. So, and then this sum is then updated with the new sum. Yeah, so once I have calculated the error, I can update the sum with the new sum. So I assume that should work. So let's try. So let's calculate the average using the Kahan summation algorithm, which I just implemented using the same parameters. And let's print this out. And let's check. Perfect. Yeah. So that's the result. Taking the average of 0.1, 10 million times should be 0.1. Yeah. So no error at all. Very nice algorithm. Okay, so here you have the algorithm on the slide. Yeah, I shortened it here a little bit, so there is no new value. Yeah, okay, so that here was our value, and then that was the new value. Okay, so I'm immediately subtracting this error here when I fetch the result, and then I use this value to add it to the sum, and I track here the error. Okay, so that's the algorithm just in the script. If you like to look at, I also have this little experiment checked in. So I can summarize this in a small theorem. So you can actually prove that the error fulfills a certain bound. So if xi denotes a sequence of floating point numbers, for example, here our realizations I array with length n, so as in these two listings, yeah, the classical one and the Kahan one, then the classical summation algorithm has that the sum S, so let S here denote the sum that we calculate in this algorithm, then this S is equal to the sum of xi, where each xi is multiplied with a relative error term. So this here is then the relative error. And this relative error is smaller than, so I prove here a bound, but in worst case, it can be in the region of this expression. So it is around 2n minus I times epsilon. So you see, it is not in the region of epsilon. Yeah. So the relative error is not in the region of epsilon. It's growing. And how is it growing? It's growing with the number linear in the number of summation terms. Okay, why is that error of this specific form? So the reason is that an earlier value enters into the summation early, and then the earlier value is part of many operations. So that value will get a larger numerical error than a later value. For the Kahan algorithm, you can prove that the final sum, so the sum that is calculated by this algorithm, is of a similar form. So the sum of all elements, each element multiplied with 1 plus delta I, where delta I is then something like the relative error, plus some additional stuff here, but this additional stuff is small. Yeah, I assume that n times epsilon square is small. So for example, if n is smaller than 10 to the power 16, yeah, so then this is still smaller than epsilon, where this delta is just epsilon. Okay, here's 2 epsilon, it's just epsilon. So the sum is accurate up to machine precision, we would say. Okay. Well, one needs here for the proof that n times epsilon is smaller than 1, yeah, or smaller than 1 divided by 8 or something like that. But n equals 10 to the power 16 is quite a huge value. You find the proof of this little theorem here in this reference, the reference that I already showed in one of the first sessions. But let me just finish this part by looking at the proof of this classical result. Yeah, because it is a bit shorter, the Kahan result is very similar. Yeah, it's done in the same way. The calculation is a bit more lengthy. Yeah, so let's try to prove here this part, that we have somehow an accumulation of the error, because then in this proof you maybe see again what's the problem. So let Si denote the partial sum. Yeah. So Si is the sum up to Xi. So what our algorithm has created, yeah, after we have reached index I. So that means that Si is Si minus 1 plus Xi, but the result rounded to floating point numbers. So again, we have to distinguish here, this here is the true mathematical function or true mathematical operation, but Si is the result after we have rounded. It's a bit difficult to prove something when we have this float function here, this rounding error function. That's not even a continuous function, but I can rewrite this little thing here as there exists a delta I, a relative rounding error, such that Si is 1 plus delta I multiplied with the true mathematical solution. So we would expect, if it would be an exact solution, that this guy here is 0, but we can only have that this guy is small in the sense that it is smaller than epsilon. So I know that Si is equal to 1 plus delta I multiplied with Si minus 1 plus Xi. And now I place here a delta I tilde, because I will later rename some delta I tildes to a delta I. Okay, so we have these delta I tildes, which are the rounding error in each summation step. So then, of course, you can iterate this stuff here, and we arrive at the final sum. And the final sum is then the sum over all Xi. So we sum here over all Xi, where each xi is multiplied with such a rounding error. And how many multiplications do we have in xi? So once xi has been part of this operation, 1 plus delta I is multiplied to this. 1 plus delta I is multiplied to this. But then in the next step, Si plus 1, the Xi is part here of this sum. And Xi is again multiplied with 1 plus delta I plus 1, 1 plus delta I plus 2, and so on. So Xi is actually multiplied with all the guys from I to n minus 1. So you see that a guy that is early in this sum gets all the rounding errors, because they are relative errors, they are multiplicative factors, all the multiplicative factors of the later operations. Okay, so we have this. And now let me maybe make this here a little bit rougher. Yeah. So this little bracket here. So assume that the delta tilde k is just equal to epsilon, yeah, so it is the worst case, yeah, then this is equal to 1 plus epsilon to the power of n minus I, and 1 plus epsilon to the power of n minus I is approximately 1 plus n minus I times epsilon. So you see that the relative error grows. And now I have here an approximate sign. So if you would like to have an estimate, you can use something like 1 plus x to the power of n is smaller than 1 plus 2nx. Yeah? As long as n times x is smaller than 1, yeah, so a little bit smaller than 1, 1 over 8 is sufficient. You can make that a bit better, but that doesn't matter. Okay, so then we have that our result follows if I define now 1 plus delta I is this product here, and I can estimate 1 plus delta I by exactly the expression that is in the theorem. Yeah, 1 plus delta I, which is similar to 1 plus epsilon to an n to a power of n minus 1, yeah? So I can bound it by 1 plus epsilon to a power of n minus 1. That's smaller or equal to 1 plus 2n minus I epsilon, yeah? So which is here what was stated in this theorem. Okay. So that was my session on summation, yeah? So here on the slide, you see the little exercise that I just did, yeah? So maybe you can also do it with floating single position numbers or different values. You can check the code, yeah? The code is again here in a Git repository, so you can just run this small code and don't have to copy it. And that was the session on computer arithmetic. Thank you.